And it is Brenda Adelman. Did I get it right, Brenda?
Yes, you did. Thank you.
And I love this. Forgiving the unforgivable, the path to freedom.
Yes.
That's pretty deep, isn't it?
It is pretty deep.
And how do we get there?
Exactly, and that's what I'm here for.
Brenda, welcome back. Thanks for coming back and talk to us, because we talked to you about a year ago.
Thank you so much.
And now we're here talking about forgiving the unforgivable. This is a workshop also.
Yeah, this is a workshop. I've been performing my one-woman show, My Brooklyn Hamlet, for the past 6 years, and I realized there was a need to create a workshop on forgiveness. In my case, the story in short is...
Right.
Well, I'll give you the fun part first. I grew up in Brooklyn with a Jewish wannabe Italian father who taught me how to drive a Cadillac at 6 and how to shoot a gun at 10. And then I had this eclectic bohemian artist mom who took me all over the world with her and read Shakespeare to me from the time I was 3. She didn't fit into Brooklyn very well. But,
and the
kind of getting that picture.
Exactly.
Shakespeare with a Brooklyn accent, that might be different.
To be or not to be, you know, that is the question. I'm a pretty good mix of the two of them. And 12 years ago, my father shot and killed my mother and then married her sister, my aunt, within months, hence the title, My Brooklyn Hamlet. And every time I do the show, people's hearts are broken open, and they look at their own lives and who they might need to forgive or who they can't forgive. And I have a master's degree in spiritual psychology, and I realized last year I have a way to help people. So I started developing this workshop, Forgiving the Unforgivable, the Path to Freedom, because really there's a misunderstanding. People think that they can't forgive because it's letting someone off the hook, it's condoning their behavior, and what I'm here to say is that's not it. It's about freeing yourself so that anger, you're not holding on to that anger and hurting yourself.
Yeah, because there's such a wall. You know,
exactly.
That wall comes up, and it's like the Berlin Wall, if you will.
It really rolls around and hurts yourself.
It comes back in.
It does not do a thing to the person you're angry with.
Right. It's kind of, you know, make this analogy, it's like taking poison and thinking the other person is going to die, but you're dying from it. For me, my anger was, I was getting depressed. Some people, you know, lash out.
So how do you start? How do you push that out of there?
I push it out by having people come see the show first. No, really, because people see what I've gone through, and I'm not at all about covering up my anger, my rage, my fury, my confusion. I'm about looking at it, embracing it, applying love to it, and being kind to myself, maybe for the choices I made, being that I was daddy's little girl. A lot of people are mad at themselves for people in their lives that they trusted. So... So this weekend I'm doing my one-woman show on Friday night and Saturday night in Flagstaff, and then I'm doing my workshop Saturday night after the performance, because really people come to the show, their hearts are open, and they don't know, you know, what's the next step. So in the workshop, I apply techniques I've used over the years, what I learned in my master's program, to help people kind of not skirt the issues, not just say, okay, I've forgiven them, not cut people out of their lives, how to actually learn what a healthy boundary is, how to love yourself enough to know how you should be treated, things like that, and how they can then bring it back into their own lives and either set healthy boundaries, learn what a toxic relationship is, really learning how to care for yourself and not having that wall up, because when you have that wall up, and I'm not saying not to have a boundary with that person, maybe not even have them in your life again, but you don't realize the ripple effect. You're not allowing yourself to be intimate with other people because you don't trust.
Well, does it or does it not dissipate the anger? Are we talking about dissipating the anger, facing it, acknowledging it, experiencing it? I mean, how do you work all that together, or do you?
Yeah, I work all of that together. It's all one thing works with another. I mean, the workshop on Saturday night is going to be very short. It's like an introduction. It's an hour just because of the time. The workshop starts at 9:30, directly after my show, which starts at 8. I also have a coaching program on forgiveness, and I do these free once-a-month tele-seminars that are coming up to help people, because it's an ongoing process, you know, and really it's about taking one thing at a time, you know, working with that and then going to the next thing. And the other important thing to say is that people think, well, I've done all that forgiveness. I don't need to do anything anymore with the ex, with whatever, right?
Yeah.
But then they have to look at their lives and say, well, how are your relationships now? Are you happy? Because I absolutely know without a shadow of a doubt that if you forgive, you will have more freedom and more joy in your life, and it's like peeling an onion. So you work on all that anger. Let's say I'll use myself as an example. I worked on all the anger I had toward my father. I thought I was done. Everything was fine. And then something triggered me. Didn't even have to be him. It was someone else did something, and it reminded me of my father. And a lot of people at that point get mad at themselves. And my thing is, don't be mad at yourself. It's like peeling an onion. It's like going around with the forgiveness, and now you're here, but you're not back where you started. You're one layer deeper. You know?
Can you recall the pivotal deciding moment, defining moment in your life when that came for you in your situation?
The first level, it was really awareness. It was, yes, I can tell you specifically with this situation. My mom died 12 years ago. It was about 5 years after it. I mean, there were levels of it, but I had had a wall up. I loved my father. I hated my father. I wouldn't talk to him, but he was in my head. And then what happened was about 5 years after she died, I was in my master's program, and I learned what a healthy boundary was for the first time in my life. And he called me, and we were having our conversation, which was very superficial because he would never answer my questions about what happened and things like that. And I'll tell you specifically what happened here. And I hope with my work people won't have to go through as dramatic things as I did. But he actually told me that he was going to sue my mother's estate for money. And I remember being devastated and then thinking, wow, this man is toxic. He's not, it's not just, oh, my dad's calling. He's got an agenda. And it was that moment of like, boom, waking up. A lot of people are just sleepwalking.
And then how do you forgive that?
It took a while. I did self-counselings, which is something I learned. A lot of journaling. I always tell people to journal your feelings out of your body, but and really be clear. You don't have to tell anyone if you don't want to, you know, and all your anger. I hate him because a lot of people want to be good. They want to be the better person. They don't realize being the better person is not automatically forgiving. It's embracing your anger. And I started writing. I started doing my poem, my poetry, my one-woman show, and I mean, there's so many different ways. I did a lot of inner child work, a lot of inner child, which is kind of reparenting myself, being the father to myself that I was looking to have him be to me. Does that, I don't know if that makes
sense.
But
during your growing up years, there was no hint of this, or was there, in looking back, in retrospect?
Yeah. Well, yeah, because I've looked back a lot, and that's the other thing, looking at your life really clearly. There were definitely hints about it, and I address it in the show, so the audience kind of knows with me when we should be smarter about things instead of, oh, isn't that funny? There was not really any physical abuse. There was a lot of emotional abuse, and there was domestic violence abuse in that guns were always around, and there was a threat of a gun. There were three different occasions, I remember, when I was a little girl, when I was a teenager, and when I was about 21, that my mother said my father pulled a gun on her. And then, because my mother went back to him after their fighting, I made it that she must have been lying, because how could he have done that and my mother go back to him? So,
well, it's a remarkable story, a remarkable transformation. Yes. And of course, My Brooklyn Hamlet happens when?
Oh, My Brooklyn Hamlet is this Friday night and Saturday night at 8 o'clock at Theatricos, which is a lovely theater in downtown Flagstaff. Theatricos.com, you can find out information, and also on my website, which is www.forgivenessandfreedom.com, and they can find out more information there. And the workshop is Saturday night, March 1st, after the performance.
Thank you, Brenda. You're always welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
What a touching story, and certainly all of us need that in our lives.
Yeah.
To be able to do that.
So. Yeah. Thank you.
Different levels for all of us, different situations, of
freedom.
Course.
Freedom. The freedom of forgiveness. Yeah.
Ryan Hanna-Smith with us, director, Smokai Museum of Indian Art and Culture. When we come back, talking about Navajo rug weaving. You stay there.